Ted, I'm going to do this. Okay. I follow my father, my old man. I follow my father. I follow my father as he makes his way down the greenhouse, delicately tottering forward, swaying slightly back, swinging his hips sideways, then plunging onward, as if to a deep beat. As a disco move, it's pretty slick, insouciant even. As a mode of reliable perambulation, it's a feat of keen nerve. My father was once a contender for the 4-minute mile. Then he went to his war at 19 and was wounded sharpish. Being prepped for an MRI scan last year, the routine question about any bits of metal in him jogged his memory for the first time in 70 years. He remembered hazily hearing a doctor bent over him in a field station, mumbling something about leaving the bullet where it was in his thigh so as not to cause any more fuss. Within a month, similarly dedicated to fusslessness, making his way back across Germany to his regiment, he was shot off a tank and lay for 24 hours before being found a second time. With a robust sense of family tradition, his own father having lost his left foot in the trenches in 1917, he lost his left leg at this point. I follow my father as his stairlift creeps him up the stairs. His dog tucks under his knees on the footrest for the journey, citing the same special privileges as those faithful companions immortalized under the heels of mossy stone knights on their perpetual backs under chestnut trees or vaulted ceilings. My father said little to me during my childhood, although I knew that by the time I was 12, he considered me contrary. He used this word many times with definite emphasis, as if that were the end of it, like he was nailing a banner above my head or an archivist's stamp. Looking back, I like to wonder now if it wasn't a word chosen and meted out with a sense of savored satisfaction, although, to be honest, I fully doubt it. When I was 8, I sat on the floor by the fire, leaning my back against his armchair. He reached down as he read his paper and absent-mindedly twiddled my ear. I had a small winter rip in the seam of the lobe. As he twisted, a trickle of blood made its way down my neck. I could not speak for the confusions of pain and the incredulous delight that he was showing me, however distractedly, however much he had clearly mistaken me for a spaniel, this affection, this physical familiarity and ownership. I follow my father's buggy with its bouncy cavalier caterpillar tread over the tree roots and around rhododendron dens as he parlays a running commentary on the particulars of the glories of the May garden wood. I surreptitiously film the back of his head, his conducting arm with its knotted knuckle end. I am careful not to be caught capturing. When I was 10, swinging on the back of my dining room chair one Sunday lunchtime, having told me to desist 3 times, he turned like a twist of lightning and fetched me a spank with the flat blade of the carving knife with such force and precision that there was a pink strip on the thigh south of my summer shorts for a week, and I lost my appetite for roast chicken for a good while longer. My father has soup for lunch every day except Sunday now. Soup and Melba toast. I've been trying to source double-handled soup cups, bouillon bowls, for months. There's now only one left with both ears standing. Does nobody want to drink their soup two-handed anymore? My mother died on a Wednesday morning 3 years ago in her morphine-powered bed in the drawing room, just as he was down the other end of the polished corridor starting on his breakfast. I had opened the curtains after that final night with her. The long labor of her dying was about to fold itself up. When it did, the blessed peace was everywhere. My father, having been brought to see her, sat alone for a few seconds with his beloved beyond all on earth for 58 years. I watched him through the interior window as he fished his massive handkerchief out of his pocket and powdered his cheek with it. When he left the room, his first words to my brother coming towards him were, memorably, "Well, your recce to the crematorium yesterday was not in vain." Equally memorably, when we sat around the dining room table an hour later with the undertaker discussing a date for the funeral, he declared, "Well, My diary for next week is entirely blank. As children, my brothers and I dreaded nothing quite as much as a solo drive with my father. His ability to say precisely not one thing to us during the entire journey of several hours was breathtaking. One day, he lobbed over the top of his paper, "Treasure Island," as my brothers and I struggled with a crossword clue. It was the only time he ever participated in this daily pre-lunch ritual of our school holidays, and the solution was right. Last month, watching University Challenge with my children, he called out the same answer, "Treasure Island," after 40 years. Different program, bingo again. Double bullseye, however widely spaced. My father loves Nana Mouskouri. He loves regimental band music and Morecambe and Wise and trees. He wears exquisitely jewel-colored cardigans with their elbows frayed like exotic lilies. He is as handsome and upright as a pale tribal shield. He is grand and childlike, transcendent and lost in equal measure. He is 90 now. I bring him his favorite chocolate raisins and hide them in a wooden box by his chair. We never refer to the supply. Its reliability has become part of our shared ideology, my old man and me. Thank you.